Warble child, make passionate my sense of hearing. Sweet air, go, tenderness of years, take this key, give enlargement to the swain, bring him festinately hither. I must employ him in a letter to my love.
Master, will you win your love with a French brawl?
How means that? Brawling in French?
No, my complete master. But to jig off a tune at the tongue's end, canary to it with your feet, humour it with turning up your eyelids, sigh a note and sing a note, sometimes through the throat, as if you swallowed love with singing love. Sometimes through the nose, as if you snuffed up love by smelling love. With your hat penthouse-like or the shop of your eyes. With your arms crossed on your thin belly doublet like a rabbit on a spit. Or your hands in your pocket like a man after the old painting. And keep not too long in one tune, but a snip and away. These are compliments. These are humours. These betray nice wenches that would be betrayed without these, and make them men of note, do you note me, that most are affected to these.
How hast thou purchased this experience?
By my penny of observation.
But oh, but oh!
The hobby horse is forgot.
Call'st thou my love hobby horse?
Oh, no, master, the hobby horse is but a coat, and your love perhaps a hackney. But have you forgot your love?
Almost I have.
Negligent student, learn her by heart.
By heart and in heart, boy.
And out of heart, master. All those three I will prove.
What wilt thou prove?
A man, if I live. And this by in and without, upon the instant. By heart you love her, because your heart cannot come by her. In heart you love her, because your heart is in love with her. And out of heart you love her, being out of heart that you cannot enjoy her.
I am all these three.
And three times as much more, and yet nothing at all.
Fetch hither the swain, he must carry me a letter.
A message well sympathized, a horse to be ambassador for an ass.
Ah, what sayest thou?
Marry, sir, you must send the ass upon the horse, for he is very slow gated. But I go.
The way is but short, away.
As swift as lead, sir.
The meaning, pretty ingenious, is not lead a metal heavy, dull, and slow?
Many may, honest master, or are the master know?
I say lead is slow.
You are too swift, sir, to say so. Is that lead slow which is fired from a gun?
Oh, sweet smoke of rhetoric, he reputes me a cannon. And then the bullet, that's he. I shoot thee at the swain.
Thump, then, and I flee.
Most acute juvenile, voluble and free of grace. By thy favour, sweet welkin, I must sigh in thy face. Most rude melancholy, valour gives thee place. My herald is returned.
A wonder, master, he is a costard broken in his shin.
Some enigma, some riddle, come thy l'envoi, begin.
No enigma. No riddle, no l'envoi, no salve in the mail, sir. Oh, sir, plantain, a plain plantain. No l'envoi, no l'envoi, no salve, sir, but a plantain.
By virtue, thou enforcest laughter. Thy silly thought, my spleen, the heaving of my lungs provokes me to ridiculous smiling. Oh, pardon me, my stars. Doth the inconsiderate take salve for l'envoi, and the word l'envoi for a salve?
Do the wise think them other? Is not l'envoi a salve?
No page, it is an epilogue or discourse to make plain. some obscure precedence that hath tofore been same. I will example it. The fox, the ape, and the humble bee were still at odds, being but three. There's the moral. Now the l'envoi.
I will add the l'envoi. Say the moral again.
The fox, the ape, and the humble bee were still at odds, being but three.
Until the goose came out of door and stayed the odds by adding four. Now will I begin your moral, and do you follow with my l'envoi. The fox, the ape, and the humble bee were still at odds, being but three.
Until the goose came out of door, staying the odds by adding four.
Good l'envoi, ending in the goose. Would you desire more?
The boy hath sold him a bargain, a goose that's flat. Sir, your pennyworth is good, and your goose be fat. To sell a bargain well is as cunning as fat and loose. Let me see, a fat l'envoi? Aye, that's a fat goose.
Come hither, come hither. How did this argument begin?
By saying that a costard was broken in the shin, then called you for l'envoi.
True, and I for a plantain. Thus came your argument in. Then the boy's fat l'envoi, the goose that you bought, and he ended the market.
But tell me, how was there a costard broken in a shin?
I will tell you sensibly.
There was no feeling of it, Mott. I will speak that l'envoi. I costard running out, that was safely within, fell over the threshold and broke my shin.
We will talk no more of this matter.
Till there be more matter in the shin.
Sirrah Costard, I will enfranchise thee.
Oh, marry me to one, Francis. I smell some l'envoi, some goose in this.
By my sweet soul, I mean setting thee at liberty, enfreedoming thy person. Thou wert immured, restrained, captivated, bound.
True, true. And now you will be my purgation and let me loose.
I give thee thy liberty, set thee from durance, and in lieu thereof impose on thee nothing but this. Bear this significant to the country maid Jaconetta. There is remuneration. For the best ward of mine honour is rewarding my dependence. Ma, follow.
Like the sequel, I seal your postcard, adieu.
My sweet ounce of man's flesh, my ink and adieu. Now, will I look to his remuneration? Remuneration. Oh, that's the Latin word for three farthings. Three farthings, remuneration. What's the price of this inkle?
One penny.
No, I'll give you a remuneration. Why, it carries it. Remuneration. Why, it is a fairer name than French crown. I will never buy and sell out of this word.
My good name, Costard, exceedingly well met.
Pray you, sir, how much carnation ribbon may a man buy for a remuneration?
What is a remuneration?
Marry, sir, half penny farthing.
Why then, three farthing worth of silk?
I thank your worship. God be with you.
Stay, slave. I must employ thee. As thou wilt win my favour, good my knave, do one thing for me that I shall entreat.
When would you have it done, sir?
This afternoon.
Then I will do it, sir. Fare you well.
Thou knowest not what it is.
I shall know, sir, when I have done it.
Why, villain, thou must know first.
I will come to your worship tomorrow morning.
It must be done this afternoon. Hark, slave, it is but this. The princess comes to hunt here in the park, and in her train there is a gentle lady. When tongues speak sweetly, then they name her name, and Rosaline. Ask for her, and to her white hand see thou do commend this sealed-up counsel. There's thy garden. Go.
Garden! Oh, sweet garden! Better than a remuneration. 11 pence farthing better. Most sweet garden. I will do it, sir, in print. Garden!
Remuneration.
And I, forsooth, in love. I, that have been love's whip, a very beadle to a humorous sigh, a critic, nay, a night-watch constable, a domineering pedant o'er the boy, than whom no mortal so magnificent, this wimpled, whining, purblind, wayward boy, this senior junior, giant dwarf, Dan Cupid, regent of love rhymes, lord of folded arms, the anointed sovereign of sighs and groans, liege of all loiterers and malcontents, dread prince of plackets, king of codpieces, sole imperator and great general of trotting parators. Oh, my little heart! And I to be a corporal of his field and wear his colours like a tumbler's hoop. What I love, I sue. I seek a wife, a woman that is like a German clock, still a repairing, ever out of frame, and never going aright, being a watch, but being watched that it may still go right. Nay, to be perjured, which is worst of all, and among three, to love the worst of all, a whitely wanton with a velvet brow, with two pitchforks stuck in her face for eyes. Aye, and by heaven, one that will do the deed, though Argus were her eunuch and her guard, and I to sigh for her, to watch for her, to pray for her. Go to! It is a plague that Cupid will impose for my neglect of his almighty, dreadful, little might. Well, I will love, write, sigh, pray, sue, and groan. As some men must love my lady, and some Joan.